So why bother with calculus? Well, there's all sorts of really good reasons for knowing about calculus and using calculus. And one of the best things about calculus are derivatives. And here's a good example of how to use a derivative in an everyday engineering application. So we'll take a look at a dial right here. So a dial turns, right, like that, and it turns around its center. And we can describe the motion of turning from one number to another as something called a sigmoid. And a sigmoid, if we graph it, looks something like this. So here's a graph of time versus angle, angle being theta in this case. And if I take the motion of a typical dial moving from one angle to another, it would look something like this. It's what we call a sigmoid, like this. Now, a sigmoid starts at an angle here, so this is the start right here, and it will end at this angle right there. So start, end, end. And the thing is about a sigmoid that's kind of interesting is it's slowest at the end and slowest at the beginning, but right in the middle, right here, it's really fast. So we've spoken about the concept of the movement of the dial as a sigmoid. Let's actually write that sigmoid function out in a program called Maple. And so what you can see is the actual equation right here. And I will create a plot of it like this. So you can see that the plot in Maple looks similar to the hand-drawn plot that I had before. I can go even one better than that. So if I right-click on that equation, I can say differentiate with respect to time or with respect to t. And so I've got the time derivative of that sigmoid function. I can also plot that. So I right-click on the equation and I do a plot like this. So I'm going to color this plot in green. And I'm going to make that line a little bit wider, like that. And do the same thing to that sigmoid right here. I'm going to make that line wider. Like that. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to superimpose one on top of the other so you can see both the sigmoid and its time derivative. So the sigmoid is in dark red and the derivative, the time derivative, is in green. And what you can see is, just like I said before, the maximum speed or the maximum velocity or the maximum derivative is always found at the center of that sigmoid. So now that we have this concept down, let's take a look at what happens when we actually implement this in real electronics hardware. Okay, so now we're ready to implement real calculus on real hardware. So what we have here is a microprocessor. We have a dial or potentiometer right here, and then some LEDs right beside the dial. And what will happen is that there's code inside this microprocessor that will read the angle at which I'm turning this dial right here. And the faster I turn the dial, or the greater the derivative of the motion of the dial, the more LEDs will turn up. So if I go really slow, like this, one LED turns on. If I go a little bit faster, I get two LEDs that turn on. If I go really fast, three, I'll reset it, go really fast, and I get four. And so the way this works basically is I've got code written up that configures four LEDs. I have some code as well that measures time. I've got specific code to read the value of that dial. And then I've got some code in here that calculates the difference in time from one measurement to another measurement. And I've got code here that calculates the difference in angle, effectively, from one measurement to another measurement. And I take those two differences, the change in time and the change in angle, and I can create a derivative from it. From there, I just have some code that turns on a bunch of LEDs. And it's that simple. So basically what I do is, I'm going to reset it right here. I turn really slowly, oops, like that, and one or two LEDs turns on. If I go really fast, four LEDs turn on. It is the actual implementation of actual calculus as an actual derivative on actual hardware.